Straße. Nun ade, du stilles Dach, Vater, Mutter, sahn mir traurig, und die Liebste sah mir nach, und die Liebste sah mir nach.
Simon & Schuster Audio presents Belonging, A German Reckons with History and Home, by Nora Krug. Read by the author.
To my old family and my new family. From the notebook of a homesick emigre, Things German, number one, Hansaplast. Hansaplast is a brand of bandage developed in 1922. My mother applied it to my bleeding knee after a roller skating accident when I was 6 years old. Next to my mother, Hansaplast was the safest thing in the world. No matter if your skin is thick or thin, smooth or wrinkly, dry or moist, Hansaplast is so reliable that it won't come off until your wound has fully healed. It is the most tenacious bandage on the planet, and it hurts when you tear it off to look at your scar. It was one of my very first encounters in New York City. I was standing on the rooftop of my friend's apartment building, the only person I knew so far in the city. I had just moved here from Berlin to study. I didn't know anyone. No one knew me. Everything was possible. An elderly woman sitting in a lounge chair had overheard our conversation. "Where are you from?" she asked me. "I'm from Germany." That's what I thought. "Have you ever been to Germany?" I asked. "Yes, a long, long time ago." She avoided eye contact, and then I understood. She went on to tell me about how she had survived the concentration camp because one of the female guards had rescued her from the gas chamber 16 times at the last moment. The guard, who had exhibited merciless violence toward everyone else in the camp, regularly knocking prisoners' heads together for punishment, had, the elderly woman suspected, a secret crush on her. 16 times on the edge of the gas chamber. 16 times escaping immediate death by a hair's breadth. 16 times seeing others walk to their deaths while you must live. A familiar heat began to form in the pit of my stomach. How do you react as a German, standing across from a human being who reveals this memory to you? I remained silent. "That was a long time ago," she finally said. "I'm sure things have changed. You seem like someone who was raised by loving parents." I nodded. One, early dawning. Our backyard in Karlsruhe, in the south of Germany, faced a US military airbase where planes regularly took off and landed. I heard them hissing and roaring above our house like dangerous animals that had unbelievably decided to spare our lives. Part of me understood that something had once gone horribly wrong. Here are excerpts from the 1945 US War Department film Your Job in Germany, written by Theodore Geisel, better known as Dr. Seuss. "You'll see ruins. You'll see flowers. You'll see some mighty pretty scenery. Don't let it fool you. You are in enemy country. You are up against German history." Chapter 1. The Führer, Bismarck. The title, Blood and Iron. Nice country, Germany. Tender people, the Germans. Chapter 2. The New Führer. Kaiser Wilhelm, new title, Deutschland über alles, and the same tender German people smacked us with their World War I. We finally knocked that Führer out. We marched straight into Germany and said, why, these people are okay. It was just the Kaiser we had to get rid of. This is really some country. When it comes to culture, they lead the whole world. We pulled out our armies, and they flung chapter 3 in our faces. Führer number 3, Hitler. Slogan number 3, today Germany is ours, tomorrow the whole world. And chapter 4, it can happen again. The next war. The German lust for conquest is not dead. Practically every German was part of the Nazi network. Practically everything you believe in, they have been trained to hate and destroy. The German people are not our friends. However sorry they may seem, they cannot come back into the civilized fold just by sticking out their hand and saying, I'm sorry. Don't clasp that hand. It's not the kind of a hand you can clasp in friendship. Trust none of them. Someday, the German people might be cured of their disease, the super race disease, the world conquest disease. But they must prove that they have been cured beyond the shadow of a doubt before they ever again are allowed to take their place among respectable nations. Until that day, we stand guard. That is your job in Germany. My brother and I had never met any of the American soldiers who, since the end of the war, had been stationed in our town to protect us from resurging Nazism and the threat of communism, but we knew quite a bit about them. Americans chewed gum. They put their feet on tables. They read Donald Duck in bed without taking off their shoes, and they still had the death penalty. They had given chocolate to our Aunt Karin when she came back from evacuation in the countryside after the war, the first chocolate she had ever had. The Amis, as we called them, cruised the streets in their extravagant, fake wood-paneled cars and stopped in for hamburgers at the American supermarket, which we weren't allowed to enter because we didn't have American IDs. We used the word Amischickse for an American woman with pink fingernails and cotton candy hair, not knowing that the term had originally been used in the 1940s for German women who fraternized with men from the American occupying force. We also didn't know that Schickse was a Yiddish word, nor for that matter what Yiddish was. I don't remember when I first heard the word Konzentrationslager, but I became aware of it long before I learned about the Holocaust. I sensed that concentration camps were sinister places, and I imagined that the people who lived there were forced to concentrate to the point of physical anguish. But I was too afraid to ask, feeling that this was something embarrassing to talk about, something that grown-ups discussed in whispers, something evoking the same unsettling feeling as the man who sometimes gave candy and balloons to my brother and me when we were playing alone in the front yard. Are Jews evil? I asked my mother one day after coming home from elementary school. It was around the time that I had made it a habit to change into the panther costume she had sewn me for carnival. Of course they aren't. Who told you that? She stopped stirring and vigorously rubbed her hands dry on her apron. My religion teacher said it was the Jews who killed Jesus. Not knowing any Jews, I assumed that they didn't exist outside of the Bible. They seemed distant, like a long-extinct species. Experiencing my mother's anger, I concluded that day that Jews, all Jews, were good. One of my favorite books as a child was Der Struwwelpeter, a collection of 19th-century illustrated stories about children who get punished for misbehaving. The book was considered outdated because of its moral severity, but my mother happened to keep her old childhood copy on the family bookshelf. The story that stuck with me most was about a girl alone at home with her cats who plays with matches and burns herself into a heap of ash. The girl's demise was depicted in colorful exaggeration. What the story taught me was that you shouldn't feel sorry for yourself if you were responsible for your own downfall. Throughout my childhood, the war was...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.